The Closing of Magno, the Quintessential New York Screening Room. This Wednesday, the famed Magno Screening Rooms in New York, at 729 7th Avenue, near the corner of W. 49th Street, will close their doors for the very last time. They've been there for 68 years, and for those of us who are lucky enough to include watching a movie in the middle of the day as part of our jobs, and who have spent more of our daily lives watching movies in those two rooms, especially the main one, Magno 01, than we have anywhere else, it feels like the curtain is coming down on something. Apart from the boilerplate and veneer nostalgia that always accompanies a moment like this, I wonder, in a way, if it is the end of an era. I wonder if it's one more telling, creeping example of the metaphysic of movies transitioning from a shared experience to a solitary viewer fixed on the small screen transaction. I suspect I speak for more than a few movie critics when I say that Magno wasn't just a screening room. It was a ritual, a second home, a connection to the past, and a rather perverse joke. The joke is that for a place that hosted screenings of many of the most vital films around, it has always been a notably flawed venue. It is, for one thing, a little grubby. The 9 or 10 rows of seats are raked ever so slightly. Imagine stadium seating as first designed in 1890, but the screen itself, which is a perfectly good size, is sunk down a bit too low, so that if you're sitting in, say, the 3rd row, or the 4th row, or 5th row, or just about any row, and the place is at all full, you are liable to find yourself tilting to the side to see around the person in front of you and take in the whole screen. That the most widely used screening room in New York had the worst sight lines of any screening room you could imagine is one of those quirks that make life interesting. But the comedy of Magno is that it's a New York phenomenon that no one even bothered to complain about, because it's just something that you accepted, like the tourist hordes of Times Square or the sound of Michael Savage blaring from a cab driver's radio. In so many ways, though, it was the place. I saw Reservoir Dogs there, and Boogie Nights, and The Piano and the Wrestler, and Menace to Society and Mulholland Drive, and Lost in Translation and Memento and The Separation and Birdman. The screening room across the hall, Magno 2, was the one you thought of as too small, and it was, but if you sat in the back row, as was my insistent custom, there were, I believe, only 5 rows. It gave you an ironically panoramic view of a screen that loomed up before you. The greatest film I ever saw in that tiny room was Ed Wood, and to this day, when I think of Ed Wood, which I've seen a dozen times, the first thing that flashes into my head is watching it at Magno 2. Magno was created in 1950, it also had a sound and recording studio, which will continue on in another location, and in the 80s, when I first started coming to New York for screenings, it was one of a handful of screening rooms that were rented out to show a mixture of studio and, mostly, independent features. Other rooms were notably cushier, like the Broadway screening room in the fabled Brill Building, with its plush wide seats and womb-like aura of inner sanctum exclusivity, or Tadao, a sprawling, high-ceilinged facility that had the greatest sound of any of them. Yet in the last decade, as those rooms closed down, Magno, though it isn't quite the last of them, became the last New York screening room that felt like a hub. With its shaggy accessibility and center of Midtown location, it seemed to take the very idea of watching a movie before it came out, in a hobbit hole chamber sprinkled with media and film world people, and democratize it. The studios, like Fox and Warner Brothers and Universal, always tended to use their own screening rooms, and still do, though every so often they would use Magno. What began to change in the 2000s was the introduction of DVDs to film critic culture. They became an additional way to pre-screen a movie. The DVDs were called screeners, and though this was a convenience I held out from partaking in as long as humanly possible, believing that it wasn't fair to the movies, a film you screened on DVD wasn't being experienced on a level playing field with a movie you saw in a screening room, the battle was doomed. Now, instead of DVDs, there are links. At any moment, you're a click and a password away from